Hey, if you're here for the first time today, you can feel very confident that you didn't sit in someone else's seat because they're all brand new, all right? How about that? Yes, brand new chairs for our sanctuary this morning. And I just want to thank all the folks that showed up yesterday. There was a prayer breakfast here, and then the chairs came in, and they unloaded the chairs, and then over in the fellowship hall, the stage was removed to make more room for things that are going on over there, and I had nothing to do with any of it. So just thank you so much for getting all that done, and all the guys that showed up and made that happen and got all these in. And now, if you were in Sunday school this morning, your Sunday school was a lot more comfortable because the chairs that were here, how about that, huh? All those chairs went back into our Sunday school space, and now we don't have to cart chairs from the fellowship hall to the Sunday school rooms and back and forth. That's another blessing. So God has been very gracious to us and very good to us, and we want to thank all of the folks, decorating team, all the way down for our trustees and everybody for making this happen for us, and they're finally in. We really appreciate everybody that had a hand in making this happen. Tonight is our senior adult banquet. We got several folks signed up for that, and so if you're helping or if you're participating, looking forward to that. It's going to be a great time this evening for our folks, and looking forward to that. We worked on some pork loin last night until we got the temperature just right. That happened at about midnight. Nathan happened to text me, and he's like, "Did you get the loins cooked?" And I'm like, "Actually, we're right here at this moment." So we just got them done, and so everything was good to go. And so we're looking forward to a great, great evening. Next week is our church council meeting after our morning service, after the 11 o'clock service, and we are anticipating all the things that we have coming up this spring. So if you're a part of a team or a committee, whatever you guys have, whatever leadership role you have, we'd love for everyone to stay with us, and we're going to have some food for you, and we want to go over and begin discussing all of the things that we have upcoming for 2017, particularly in the first quarter, first half of the year. We're going to be laying out a lot of neat things. And we've got really something special in mind for Easter this year, and we're getting ready to roll that out. So we want everyone to be involved and excited about what God is doing, so because we're very excited about that. We have a lot of things going on at Living Faith. Wednesday night, we had a very positive special call business meeting. The church at that meeting made the decision to create three new positions, really kind of moving some around and then creating two new positions for our church, additional pastor staff for our church. So to do with cows, and I needed him to be doing those things, and he couldn't get out of the bed. And I remember praying, "God, heal him. Heal him." And in 1985, he went to be with the Lord. He died. And I was confused. In September of 1996, I became a pastor. I surrendered to the call of the ministry. And in December, I went to church at Independence Baptist Church down in McHenry, and I preached my first sermon there, and my grandmother, Dad's mom, my Mimi, she came to hear me. It was a pretty cool day. I remember hugging her and shaking her hand on the porch, and her telling me that she was going into the hospital for some tests the next day, and I said, "I'll be in prayer for you." And then just a few weeks later, we're around her bedside, and the doctor's saying he don't think she's going to come out of it. And right after Christmas, and I prayed, "I'm a pastor, Lord. I'm doing what you told me to do. We're getting this thing done. We're doing what we're supposed to." And she died right after Christmas. And it leaves you in a place of asking the question, why? You see, cancer, heart failure, depression, dementia, all of these things that we face, all of these ailments, all of these issues that we run into, nothing will bend your knees faster than your health or the health of somebody that you love dearly. It will bring us to our knees, and we find ourselves asking the question, why? Why? Our good friend Harvey, right here last week, and now he fell from a golf cart, and his cancer had returned, and it broke his leg. And when I went to the hospital yesterday, I held onto his hands and I prayed for God to heal him. You see? Prayed for God to heal him. It happens. And so we're left to ask the question, what will God do? We need the Lord to shepherd us through our illness, through our sickness. And the question is, will He? Will He? My God, my God. We see people prayer for people that are bedridden. You know, all of us in this room have been to see Joey, and we look and we say, God. You know, all of us have. And so we're asking the question, why? What? We see salt of the earth folks that are just struck down in their prime. We see people who do evil live into their triple digits. Okay? I get that. You see it? They've been in prison maybe for years, and all of a sudden they appear on TV or put out a Facebook video, and you're like, what? What, God, what? Are you seeing this? Are you catching this? Are you seeing this happen? Are you paying attention? So how do we explain this? How do we explain this? How do we explain the why and when of God's healing? Let's take a trip back to Jericho with Matthew and go to verse 29 in the 20th chapter and look at this event that took place. As Jesus and his disciples were leaving Jericho, a large crowd followed him, as they always did. Wherever he went, there were always crowds, and there were two blind men who were sitting by the roadside. When they heard that Jesus was going by, they shouted, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us, as the crowd goes on. The crowd rebuked them. Shh, be quiet, be quiet. It's Jesus. We got things going on here. But they shouted all the louder, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. And Jesus stopped and called them. What do you want me to do for you? He asked. Lord, they answered, we want our sight. We want our sight. Jesus had compassion on them, and he touched their eyes, and immediately they received their sight and followed him. Now, Jesus healed a lot of people. At this time, at this place, his popularity was at high tide. 3 years of feeding and healing and teaching had elevated Jesus to rock star status in that time period, okay? The people around knew who he was, and they knew when he was moving. They knew when he was traveling. And if you were sick, if you were suffering, if you had any type of ailment, you just needed to get close to where he was, because word had gotten out that if he saw you, if he touched you, if he talked to you, if he could be in your, if you would just be in his presence and communicate with him some way, that he had the power to heal you. So people came. They wanted to be close to Jesus. The people loved him. He stood up to authorities. He commanded cadavers. He called the shots. He was blue-collared and big-hearted. And he came from Nazareth, and he wasn't in all the big fancy robes, and he talked plainly so they could understand him. And everybody wanted to be close to Jesus. It was an amazing, amazing time. And so this crowd is escorting him to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. And it's excitement. And it's awesome. And here in the midst of all of the happiness and all of the good times and all of the people with good legs and all the people with good eyes and all of the things that are going on are these two blind men on the side of the road. Have mercy on us. Have mercy on us. Can't see, probably in tattered robes, probably skin like leather from being in the sun. Pitiful, pitiful people. The people said, just be quiet, be quiet. You see, this is what happens. Afflictions have a way of sidelining the sufferer. You see, when we feel good, when our health is good, we feel like we're indestructible. Okay? We feel like we're indestructible. I remember when I got hit with the flu a few years ago, I was sitting at my desk and it was like, I don't have time to be sick. I don't have time to deal with this. I got things to do and I'm just going to keep on going. Everybody else may go to bed when they get the flu, but when I get the flu, I'm going to be fine. Okay? No. Baloney. I find myself laying in the storeroom in my classroom. I'm laying flat on my back and just laying there on the concrete floor going, God, why have you forsaken me? I'm busy. And I'm sick, okay? When our health goes, we go down. And it will sideline the sufferer. Everybody else has a place in the parade. And hey, I'd be glad to get back in the parade too. But when I can't go, I can't go. And then we wonder, what do we do with this ailment? What do we do when we can't do? What do we do when we can't go? What do we do when we just can't seem to get ourselves up and move forward? Well, the first thing is we do what Mary did last week. She took it to Jesus. When she saw the problem at the wedding, there's a problem. And she took the problem to Jesus and said, whatever he says, do, do. We'll let him handle it. But here's the thing. That's what these guys did. They took their concern to Jesus. They didn't ask for Peter. They didn't ask for John. They didn't make any request of the other disciples. They went straight to the top. They cried out to Jesus. They cried out persistently. They cried out personally. They cried out passionately. We need help. I need help. Heal me. Here's why you need to do the same. Okay? Because God's goal for you is wholeness. You need to know that. His goal for you is wholeness. So when you realize that you're broken in some way, whether it's physical, emotional, whatever it is, when you realize that you're broken, you need to cry out to God to heal you, because His goal for you is wholeness. It's always that. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23 say, May God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Through and through. Your whole spirit, your whole soul, and your whole body. His goal for you is wholeness. It always has been. See, God envisions a complete restoration of the Garden of Eden. When God looked upon His creation, He said, this is good. When He looked upon Adam and Eve, He said, this is very good. Okay? All of it together. They weren't sick. They weren't crippled. They weren't depressed. They weren't afflicted. They were spiritually and physically sound. There was no emphysema, palsy, or paranoia in the Garden of Eden. Everything was right. But you need to know this. When they rebelled, okay? When they rebelled, everything fell out of harmony. Everything fell out of harmony. It's called the fall. And it's called the fall for a reason. Because everything fell out of harmony. And Adam and Eve had a falling out with God. And they had a falling out with each other. And nature fell out of whack. Okay? And that's why we have jonquils and daffodils blooming in February. That's why that's why nature happens the way it happens. That's why things are just crazy. Okay? We think, well, it's, you know, there's no normal. Okay? Normal is just average. You just take it all and put it together and average it. But nature is out of whack. Things happen, it's crazy. One day is one thing, one day it's another. The fall was a fall from wholeness. The human body fell out of balance. The fall was what it is. It was a fall from wholeness. Sin opened the door, and sickness walked in. Okay? Sin opened the door, and sickness walked in. Look at Romans 5:12. It spells it out. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people, because all sinned. When sin opened the door, sickness walked in, and there we have it. And here's the thing. Sin and sickness are together. The consequences of the same rebellion. When you look at someone and go, how can that person love Jesus? How can that person be a Christian and that happened to them? Hey, it's all part of the same reason. We're all going to die, okay? None of us are going to make it out of this world alive. You're all going to experience death unless He returns and takes us home. Okay? Unless you're part of that crowd, there's going to be a group. Okay? But if not, then you're going to experience a physical death. And the reason that you have to experience that physical death is because of sin. And all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And because of that, we all can experience sickness the same way. When Isaiah foretold of Jesus, he told us this. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on Him, and by His wounds we are healed. Back it up one verse to verse 4. Surely He took up our pain and bore our suffering. Jesus didn't just die for your sin, He died for your sickness too. He died for all of it. He died for all of it. Jesus treated our sickness the same way He treated our sin. He took it away. He took it away. He bore it in Himself on the cross. And when Matthew saw all of the healing that He did, when Matthew witnessed this, this is what he wrote in verse 17 of chapter 8. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah. He took up our infirmities and He bore our diseases. When Jesus was on this planet, He was taking it away, and Matthew was like, wow, this is what He does for us. This is what He does for us. And when He went to the cross, He did it for all of us. He did it for all of us. Did Jesus die for your sins? Yes. Did Jesus die for your sickness too? Yes. Yes, He did. It's inconsistent to say that Jesus saved your soul but not your body. When he took our sins to the cross, He took our cancer, He took our disfigurements, He took depression, He took it all. So we find ourselves saying, I don't know what you're thinking. I don't know what you're asking. Why do we get sick? If Jesus took all that to the cross, then why do we still see it? Why do we still experience it? Why are we vulnerable to it? Why do we still get sick? It's for the same reason that we still sin. Because we live in a fallen world. We live in a fallen world. Listen, hear me. Jesus died for your sins. And when you come and you accept His death on the cross, when you accept the price that He paid for you for your sins, and then you leave that altar of prayer, you leave that place where you make that decision, and you happen to slip up again and make another mistake, I got good news for you. He died for that sin too. Okay? He died for the sin that you haven't committed yet. Okay? Because none of you are perfect. And just because you accept Christ as your Lord and Savior doesn't make you perfect as you live in this body, as you live in this earth. You will make a mistake again. You will, because you're human and you live in a fallen world. And if you're human and you live in a fallen world, you can't be perfect. Okay? You can't be perfect. And He died for what you haven't done yet. Isn't that amazing? Does that give you a license to sin? Paul said, no, God forbid. Okay? God forbid. But when we do, we don't have to go back. Jesus doesn't have to go back to the cross. Okay? And you don't have to go back and start all over again. You are in a continual forgiveness. Okay? It is a continual process of repentance and forgiveness. And it's what He did for you. And because you live in a fallen world, and because you can still sin again, you can also get sick. It's a fallen world. And the kingdom is a coming kingdom. Sickness and sin are a part of the planet in which we live. It's a part of a fallen world in which we live. But here's the difference. Sickness nor sin has dominion over God's people. Neither sin nor sickness have dominion over God's people. Sin cannot condemn us. Disease cannot destroy us. Guilt becomes defanged and death loses its sting. Because the very sin and the very sickness that Satan intends for evil, God redeems it for good. God redeems it for good. Sin becomes a showcase of His grace. Sin becomes a showcase of its grace. It's your testimony. It's who you were and who you are now. Okay? It's a showcase of His grace. Sin becomes a showcase for what God has done in your life. Okay? It becomes a showcase for who you were and who you are now. And that is an amazing thing. It is your story. Sickness becomes a demonstration of God's ability to heal. Sickness becomes a demonstration of God's ability to heal. You see, we aren't victims of rogue molecules and rebellious cells. We don't live beneath the specter of some uncontrollable plagues or emotions. Every fiber, every molecule and brainwave answers to His command. He is in control. So if you are sick, then you need to cry out to Jesus. Take it to Him. It doesn't matter. If it's your stomach, if it's your skin, if it's moles, it doesn't matter. Your whole body. 1 Corinthians 6:20 says this, you were bought with a price. Okay? You were bought at a price. So honor God with your bodies. Do the same with your emotions. Has someone hurt you? Not physically, but in here? Maybe you've been a victim of something terrible in your past. Maybe you were molested. Maybe you were abused as a child. Maybe you've experienced an abortion. I don't know. I don't know what that is. But that's when we need inner healing, okay? That's when we need inner healing. And He does that too, okay? God will heal you. And here's the thing. When you ask Him to heal you, He's going to heal you in one of three ways. I can promise you this. He will heal you instantly. He will heal you gradually. Or He will heal you ultimately. Okay? Now that's hard for us to take sometimes. Understand that. Okay? Sometimes He will heal you. He will heal you instantly. Sometimes He will heal you gradually. And sometimes He heals you ultimately. He may heal you instantly. One word was enough for Him to banish demons, heal epilepsy, and raise the dead. That's all it takes, and He still has that power. All He had to do was speak the word, and healing happened. And He may do this for you. He may do this for you. But for some, it may be gradual. Okay? For some, it may be gradual. In Mark chapter 8, verse 22, he shows us that they came to Bethsaida, and some people brought a blind man and begged Jesus to touch him. So all he had to do was touch his eyes and he'd be healed and have his sight, right? Didn't work quite that way. He took the blind man by the hand and led him outside the village. He spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him. And Jesus asked, "Do you see anything?" And he said, I see people, but they look like trees walking around. Once more, Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes. And then his eyes were opened and his sight was restored. And he saw everything clearly. He healed him gradually. He healed him gradually. I don't know why He didn't heal him instantly, but He healed him gradually. He sent him home. He healed him gradually. Some of you have experienced that, okay? Michelle, you've experienced that, okay? It took a little while, but you feel better. It's a gradual healing. It's a gradual process. I can't answer the question as to why He chooses which process by which He uses, okay? I can't answer that for you. But I can tell you and promise you that Jesus will heal you. When He heard that his friend Lazarus was sick, He could have healed him from where he was sitting. Instead, He waited. As a matter of fact, He waited until he died. You knew he was sick? Yep. You're going to let him die? Yep. Why? He had a point to make. Okay? He had a point to make. And it was to glorify Him. You see, He healed Lazarus, but He healed him dramatically, but it wasn't instantly. He let him get sick to the point that he died and had been in the tomb for 4 days. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 2. It says, "Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known." Friends, that's ultimate healing. Okay? That's wholeness in a way that we don't understand it yet. And that's what He did for my grandfather in 1985. Okay? My desire and what I needed was different than what God did. And so my papa received an ultimate healing from his cancer. And when I saw him suffering and knew what he was going through, I was praying for any kind of healing. Okay? I was praying for instant healing, but I was praying for any kind of healing. And so he now has something that I don't even understand yet. What we know is that when Christ appears, we will be like Him. And we shall see Him as He is. That's going to be a cool day. Okay? It's going to be a cool day. But until then, if Jesus heals you instantly, you need to praise Him. Okay? If Jesus heals you instantly, you need to praise Him. Because if you're still waiting for healing, you just need to trust Him. Because your suffering becomes your sermon. Your suffering becomes your sermon, and He will use your struggle. He will use your struggle to help and change others. Or He may use your struggle to change you. Over my whole life as an educator and a pastor, I have struggled with bad feet. Okay? Now, you're saying, we got cancer and all these things going on, and you're going to talk to us about your feet. Yeah, I got a point. Okay? When you're hurting, you're hurting. Okay? It doesn't matter if it's chronic, if it's traumatic, or what it is. If you can't stand up, you can't stand up. And I'll never forget when it came on for me. It was gradual, and then it kept going, and it would go away, and then it would come back, and then I'll never forget it. It's been years ago, and it happened on a Friday. I was in Murray at a FFA leadership conference, and I was gone on a bus all day. We had to start at 6 o'clock in the morning. Came home, football game that night, working the concession stand till about 10, 11 o'clock at night. So it was one of those nice full 15, 16 hour days that I do a lot of. And I was hurting so bad I couldn't walk. And so when I got back off the bus and I was supposed to be running back and forth between the concession stands, cooking and on my feet on concrete all night, I'm at the point of just pain that I couldn't imagine. And it was more than any type of Advil would take away. And so I was just hurting. And I was sitting on the steps inside the concession stand and was just trying to get off my foot because it was hurting so bad. Every time I took a step, it was like somebody was driving a nail in the bottom of my heel. And Coach Phipps was one of our coaches at the time. And Coach and I was good friends. And Phipps comes by and looks at me. He goes, "Hey, what's wrong with you?" I was like, "Coach, I can't walk." I said, I explained to him the pain. He said, "You got plantar fasciitis. Come on." And so he takes me down to the blue building, puts me on one of the things, and he takes the plastic and he heats it and he makes an orthotic for my foot. And he puts it in my shoe and he's like, "Wear that." And so I started wearing it, and gradually, over time, it got better. It became more tolerable, and I realized that I had an issue called plantar fasciitis. And then later on, I got it in both feet. And when I was in Florida, I walked into this, I learned what a Birkenstock sandal was. And yeah, I wear Jesus sandals, and so I have them all the time. And so I go home. I can't be barefooted in my house at all. I have to wear those sandals all the time, or I can't, it hurts so bad. And so I have that, and so I had these insoles. Well, just a few years ago, I was in Florida. Or in Gatlinburg. We were in Gatlinburg for fall break, and so I woke up one morning and I was like, I'm going to go for a walk and maybe a run, just going to get out and exercise a little bit and just feel good, mountain air, and just enjoy. And you're thinking, you're too fat to run. So anyway, so I go out, and exactly, you're exactly right. So I go out for a long walk and a run, and I come back, and I lay down, took a nap, and I woke up, and when I woke up, I stood up, and it was like, I can't walk. I'm hurting so bad. My feet are hurting so bad. I cannot literally take. I need a wheelchair. I'm hurting so bad. It's like I can't walk without unbelievable pain in both of my feet. And so, and I'm just praying, Lord, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And I'm just like, please, Lord, take this pain away. It's awful, awful, awful. And so we're in there. Like, we're going to go down to the strip and eat some breakfast. And so I go down. As long as I'm sitting, I'm fine. But when I get back up on my feet, it's just unbelievable pain. And so I'm walking, and I'm praying and walking, going, I don't know how I'm going to be able to do anything the rest of the week while we're here. And I look up, and all of a sudden, there's a sign on the door, and it says, feet hurt. And I'm like, yes. Yeah, I don't care if you got snake oil or what, then I'm probably going to buy what you got. So I go in, and she's like, and she measures my feet, and she gives me these, or she sells me these insoles, and I put them in my shoes, and within 2 hours, my pain is gone. It's just gone. And it's like, this is amazing. And just last year, I twisted my back when I was working with some feeding troughs on Halloween. And it messed up my back bad. And so y'all don't probably, some of you won't remember it, but there was a time I think I came and sat on a stool and I was eating Advil and it's like I was hurting bad. And so it got better. And then they diagnosed me with sciatic nerve pain in my right leg. And so for 3 months last year, it hurt every day. It hurt every step that I took. And I was just, you know, I did all the stretches and all the things that I was supposed to do. And then all of a sudden, it just went away. The pain just went away. So listen, I have experienced gradual healing, and I have experienced healing from doctors, and I have experienced instant healing. I've had that before. It's an amazing thing. When you're hurting, when you have pain, and all of a sudden it's gone, it's like, wow. I've experienced instant healing, and I've experienced gradual healing. One day, one day I'll experience ultimate healing. Okay? I look forward to that day. I mean, God has a plan for me, has a purpose for me, and I'll be the first to admit that this is probably why these don't work as well, okay? Because I don't do as good a job as I should honoring God with my body, all right? Because we live in a fallen world. We live in a broken world. And one of these days, it'll all be repaired and it'll all be fixed. And it's a struggle for all of us that we all go through. But one day, we will all experience ultimate healing. And this is what I want you to understand. And this is what I want you to know. As we go through life, as we go through those struggles, we continue to pray. Jesus, when he was walking with that crowd, I want to show you something. Back in Matthew chapter 20 and verse 31, the crowd was telling him, hey, don't just be quiet. Don't bother him. He's a busy guy. He's got a lot of things going on. But they shouted all the louder, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. And look at what Jesus did. When they called his name, he stopped. He stopped. The cry of the prayers of the people caused him to stop. Okay? And he's still the same God. And he's still the same Jesus. And he still responds to your prayer the same way. Not only did he stop, but he turned and he called to them and he said this, what do you want me to do for you? Can you imagine that? Can you imagine the author of life, the creator of the universe, the one who spoke the stars into existence, that you have the ability, when you have the relationship with him, to say, Lord, help me, heal me. And he will stop and turn to you and ask the question, what can I do for you? What do you want me to do for you? All of the noise in the midst, and he will communicate with you. What can I do for you? He heard those words and he stopped. And he still does. And he still asks, what can I do for you? They said, Lord, we want our eyes to be open so that we can see. You may say, Lord, heal this heart condition. Lord, help my feet. Lord, remove this arthritis. Lord, restore my hearing. You see, when Jesus heard their prayer, his heart went out to them. It broke his heart. He had compassion on them, and he healed them. And he'll heal you. He will heal you. My prayer is that he does it instantly. My prayer is that everybody could experience instant healing. I really pray that for you. But he may choose to heal you gradually. He may choose to put a sign in front of you, okay? And says, is your feet hurting? Then talk to me. You may be avoiding this pain, okay? And he may say, look, you're going to have to talk to somebody. I'll heal you, but I'm going to do it gradually. Okay? We got people called doctors, and I've gifted them, and I've given them the ability to do things. I don't know how he's going to choose to do that, because it may be that it's ultimate, okay? He will heal us all ultimately. Here's the good thing to remember. Wheelchairs, ointments, treatments, bandages, all of it is confiscated at the gateway to heaven. They don't exist there. God's children in that place, in that kingdom, in that time, forever and for eternity, are once again whole. We're once again made whole. So my question for you today is, what do you need him to do? What are you asking him to do? What do you want me to do for you? Is what he said to them. So what hurts? You see, it may be physical. It may be like me. You may wake up and go, that's bothering me again. I got the pain shooting going on here. Oh, this is going down. Oh, my fingers don't work. Okay? I can't see. My eyes, are not as clear. I can't hear the thunder anymore. Okay? It's time for a hearing aid. Okay? Gradual healing may be what's in store for you. It may be instant healing. But listen, don't despair ultimate healing. Don't despair ultimate healing. Because he loves you. Because he has a plan for you. And because he died for you, He will call you to be with Him. And one day, all of us will experience that ultimate healing. My prayer for you today is that you know Him so that you can. Let's pray. Father, we come before You. We ask You, Lord, to just hear our prayers, that You would just stop and hear us as we cry out for healing. Father, sometimes it's hard to accept Your plan for us when we realize that our healing may come instantly, and we all seek that. That for some, it comes gradually. And for some, it's ultimate healing, but it's still healing. Father, help us to understand that we just live in a fallen world. It's not that we've particularly done something to deserve a certain suffering or a certain illness. It's just a result of the sin that entered the world. So, Father, we need You to help us get through. We need You to guide us and to be with us. And, Lord, in this time of invitation and reflection, Father, we just pray that You'll search our hearts. Help us, Lord, to seek You. Father, maybe there's someone here this morning that doesn't have a relationship with You. They've never asked You into their heart, and they've never understood what You've done on the cross for them. That not only did You die for their sins, but You died for their bodies. That You died for all of it. That we can give it all to You. All that we experience. All the pain. All the suffering. We can just hand it over. Maybe it's not physical. Maybe it's emotional for some. Maybe it's deep down inside. We just ache. We just hurt. And it's taken us out of the game. It's taken us away from the parade. It's taken us away from the excitement. It's taken us away from serving You. And we're just on the sidelines. Father, give us the strength to just cry out. Maybe we can't cry. Maybe we just need to whisper. Maybe we just need to whisper, Jesus, heal me. You'll hear us. You'll hear us and You'll ask the same question. What do You want me to do for You? That we would be made whole. Make us whole again, Father. Make us whole. Heal us. Let this be a time of healing, Lord. We pray now, Father, that You would just guide us in this time. We ask it in Jesus' name.